anyways, inland waterways, again, something which is very, very important. Yesterday, everybody talked about it. Everybody mentioned the cost differential and how it is beneficial to us to have the inland waters. And as the chairman of the session, Commander Naik, said, it is very, very cost-effective to have the inland waterways as the primary mode of cargo carrying for bulk, at least for bulk, because then you get the economies of scale, etc., etc. It is environment friendly, cheaper, all of that. I think I will not go into the details because all of us know. Ironically, every DG shipping in Government of India has a report in his name, which is for inland waters and coastal shipping. Okay, so every DG in his tenure has touched upon this subject, ensured that the stakeholders get a feeling that, yes, I know the subject. The document is in place. But, yes, here we are where we are today. And we have seen the challenges. We have seen the difficulties. I think lobbies are really playing a big role here. And now that the government has resolved, and thanks and the credit must go to Honorable Nitinji for this, in his own style and in his own manner, he's saying, come what may, I will make inland waters work. And in his own style, he's pushing, he's cajoling. Now, those who know Nitinji, his cajoling is little different. But he's cajoling them to see to it that the inland waters become a reality. About 10 days ago, I was at Varanasi terminal, exactly on the 13th of this month. I was at Varanasi terminal to see the operations there, the multimodal terminal which the Honorable Prime Minister inaugurated a little before that. We've done this first trial of Pepsi containers from Haldia to Varanasi, and then the ship carried written cargo. When I spoke to the people who actually carried that cargo, they said, we don't see a reason why this cannot survive, why this service cannot function. On the way in the river, whatever challenges were there, apparently to them those are minor challenges. Those are not serious challenges, and they feel that they can run the service. The question is, where is the cargo going to come from? If you see this NW1, as they call it, NW1 has got a large population along its route, probably larger than some of the countries in the world. So there is no reason why there is no cargo support, or why there cannot be a cargo support. And I think the effort is therefore to ensure that the service runs regularly. Today it is not. Today it is as and when there is cargo, they pick up the cargo and do the run. But going forward, I'm sure people will understand the importance and they will realize. Because while I saw the terminal and I saw the ship sailing out from there, very next to it, adjacent to it, is a bridge on the Ganges. And there was a huge queue, a long congestion on that road, and the trucks coming and going all the way from Calcutta to Lucknow and further up. So therefore, I said, there is cargo. There is absolutely no problem. And there is something which is in the form of a service provider who actually loaded those containers on the ship. I asked the people there how long it took. There were two Liebherr cranes, harbor mobile cranes, there at the jetty. And I asked them, how long did it take for you to load those 100 plus containers? They said, 2 ghante mein kaam ho gaya. No, so, but then the challenge was that they said, all those 100 container hum logon ko raat mein lana pada. Yeah. Din mein wo container nahi aa sakta hai, kyunki road pe bahut traffic hai. Okay. So these are, I think, the challenges that inland waterways will have to address. Why people are not taking these modes of transport, and the same is case probably some of the coastal routes also, is that the end-to-end connectivity is not there. I don't want to get stuck with the non-waterway related challenges, and that is today the problem. We don't have the permissions in some of the cities to enter during the daytime. Therefore, my container cannot reach the terminal. And then, because I come to you 12 hours, 24 hours in advance, you charge me the rentals. Okay. So, therefore, it becomes non-viable. So, when I look at the total cost of movement of goods from destination A to destination B, all of this is also important, which unfortunately our IWI people don't understand. They say, hamara to sasta hai. Are, aapka sasta hone se fayda nahi hai na, mujhe customer ke liye sasta hona jaruri hai. So NW1, NW2, NW3, NW4 and 5 are the ones that we have been discussing for long. And then 101 new waterways added, making it 106 now in the country. The effort is basically to put all those 106 waterways under IWI so that in future, whenever there is any development that takes place on this, we don't have to again go to the state government, ask for their permission, their legislative agency taking more time to decide on this. So that is what the IWI has done. The central government has put 106 waterways now under their jurisdiction. The second, while I say NW1 will successfully operate because there is cargo, there are terminals which are now coming up. While Varanasi has started operations, the Sahibganj, Patna will soon become functional. So you have multimodal logistics parks at Haldia, Sahibganj, Patna and Varanasi. So these are the different places where the multimodal logistics parks will come up, which will support the handling of cargo for NW1. The other waterways which in my opinion will soon become functional and become viable is the waterways of Brahmani and Mahanadi opening in Paradip and Dhamra, because these two ports are doing extremely well. There is a plan for expansion of these facilities and capacity of these two ports, and these two ports are primarily for bulk cargo. And the mining that happens in the entire Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand belt, the raw materials which are required in rest of the country and at times are on the train or on the road for the states of Gujarat and Maharashtra, they will probably go on the coastal ships because then it will become viable for them to transfer large volumes through the waterways of Brahmani and Mahanadi straight opening into these ports. So that is another best part. These waterways are opening into the ports directly. So it is easy for anybody to transfer these raw materials or the bulk cargoes into a coastal ship and then send it to the southern parts or the western part. Now the Coal India production is supposed to go up in these fields in Jharkhand and Chhattisgarh, and that is to the tune of 300 million metric tons, I'm told. That the government is very keen that the mining activity by Coal India in these two states pick up. If that happens, then all of this will find natural entry into Paradip and Dhamra. And therefore, this is another waterway which will become viable. And the third waterway which is aggressively being pursued, and I spoke about it yesterday when I spoke about Northeast, is the NW2, which is the Brahmaputra and Barak river basin. Huge water body. A lot of activity is already happening, but that is totally unorganized. There is no cargo movement there. There is huge passenger movement that is taking place, which now, to an extent, will be reduced with some of these marvelous bridges that are coming up there, be it the second Brahmaputra bridge in Guwahati or the Bogiwel that is already up and opened up. The third bridge is also coming in. There are going to be totally about 8 bridges that Brahmaputra will have, which is from south bank to north bank. So the passenger movement will go down, but the cargo movement is expected to happen on the Brahmaputra. As I said, NRL is looking at sending good about 1.2 million metric tons of finished oil products to Bangladesh. There are two routes that they are looking at. One is, of course, a pipeline that is going up to Siliguri and then entering Bangladesh. And the second one is using the Brahmaputra and then opening into Bangladesh. So this is the third waterway which, according to me, will become viable. And the fourth, which probably has the potential, is the Buckingham Canal in south. Which again is a traditional canal which was used by during the British era, opening into Chennai and Krishnapatnam port. So these are again two ports which are currently doing very well. They have a lot of hinterland cargo which is moving by road at the moment. They are not even carrying it by rail because the distance is short. Because as we go into the southern peninsula, the cargo travels very short distance. There are 5 or 6 ports which compete for this cargo, right from, say, Krishnapatnam, Chennai. Then you have a port near Pondicherry. Then you have Tuticorin, and then you have Cochin. So these ports compete for the cargo in the southern hinterland peninsula, but these two, Krishnapatnam and Chennai, will have the advantage of Buckingham Canal. So cargo from the south and west, south and east Andhra Pradesh and further down, all of this will have the natural advantage of savings on land transportation cost if they use Buckingham Canal opening into these two ports. So as far as cargo carrying is concerned, I think to me these are the four potential waterways which will become viable. Of course, there is waterway in Kerala which is primarily used for the cruise or the tourism purpose, which is a declared waterway. And there is a waterway in Goa which is Mandovi and Zuari river system. But that we all know is heavily dependent on the mining in Goa, which today is not really something that can be relied upon or can be expected. So I don't see these two, although they are declared NW waterways, but I don't think they have a potential for anyone who's interested in inland waterways as a business opportunity. So these are the four waterways that I think are going to be very, very important. And they will take off a lot of cargo. As I said, NW1, almost 40 crores population along the waterways. So huge opportunity there. Brahmani and Mahanadi will facilitate the increased throughput from the mines. Brahmaputra waterways is opening up a new opportunity altogether. And Buckingham Canal, going back to the historical advantages of connecting these Chennai port. Now, having said that, we looked at some of these problems on inland waterways because we built bridges, we have built barrages without realizing that this is the cheapest and the environment friendly water transportation is the mode of transport. Therefore, we have challenges because our ships will have to be then restricted to certain size, air draft, water draft, all of those are going to be the requirements, and therefore the designs have been worked out accordingly. Brahmaputra, although it has a great potential, but then the currents are very high. The Brahmaputra keeps shifting its flow at times. So that again is going to be another challenge. And one more important thing which we have to remember is about Brahmaputra is while the for NW1, NW2, 3, 4, 5, we have a good amount of data and information about the whole water body, the prism, the tributaries, the water that flows into it during monsoon and the currents. Unfortunately, there is very little information about Brahmaputra. Brahmaputra has got about 160 tributaries, and water is coming from all over Arunachal Pradesh and Meghalaya, and God knows from where it comes. So, I mean, yes, literally, I mean, you really can't make out from where it keeps coming. And it suddenly swells, and you don't know how to navigate there. So that is one challenge in Brahmaputra. While the depth is not really the issue there, the water levels are there, but the stream keeps shifting from one place to another place. So that is going to be a challenge in Brahmaputra. So a detailed, extensive study has been initiated to understand the whole water basin of Brahmaputra. In terms of the skills, again on inland waterways, we have one institution which is based in Patna, which provides the training for river navigation. That is Indian Institute for River Navigation, based in Patna, which exclusively is meant for training people who want to take up careers on inland waters. So that, to an extent, is, I would say, is taken care. But there is no infrastructure along the waterways. The infrastructure that is required for logistics companies to operate and function. Because our banks are totally occupied by the people living along those banks. Now the logistics companies would require direct access to the waterfront, which is difficult in some of these places. But these three multimodal logistics parks on NW1 have come up in the area where that is not going to be a challenge. Or they are on the other side of the bank. I mean, like Varanasi, the terminal has come on the other side of the bank, which is really not used by the public living there in Varanasi. So likewise, there are, I mean, these issues are being addressed in some way or the other. But as I said, there is a need for people to really say that we want to use inland waterways. Not just because it reduces the cost, but there is a lot of social benefit also that is associated with it. It will bring down the fuel consumption, therefore the total import bill, and then of course the CO2 gases, that is another reason. Because most of us face this challenge when we go into the hinterland, that those smaller towns and cities are also getting choked because of the huge cargo movement that is now happening. Now, cargo movement cannot be stopped because it will only go up. It will only increase with the growing economy. And therefore, I think it is a good move to have these waterways in place. The other thing which I think is important when it comes to waterways is the fact that these skilled manpower is available only for the navigational purpose. The institute will have the manpower available only for the navigational purposes. But these new centers that will come along the waterways, there is very little understanding of the logistics, the requirements of logistics. So new opportunities will emerge for warehousing, storage, packaging, labeling, and of course the loading and unloading of this cargo. So for that, again, there is very little initiative, according to me. None of our universities or the academic institutions are even talking about it. I think it will be good if MEDC can actually sensitize institutions about this, because this is going to be a new career opportunity for our young people along the waterways. With this, I'll stop, because then we get into the operational part, probably with Dharmadhikari referring to it, and then subsequently.